So I thought I'd take as my topic today what we call Chaga Nusati. But do we know what Chaga Nusati is? Gratitude. Gratitude is Chaga Nusati, is reflecting on gratitude or reflecting on generosity. My way to generosity is a reflection on gratitude. What am I grateful for? What gifts have I received in life? And how does that feel like? How does that feel to me? The other day I shared somebody's birthday. They came to the monastery to celebrate what they call their real birthday. They had a day off school, and they came to offer food with their parents and their younger sister. And Saturday was their birthday. They were going to have a party on Saturday, but I got to enjoy their real birthday, which was during the week, which was their actual birthday. But they were looking forward to Saturday. They were going to party on Saturday with all their friends. And it's very interesting to be with an 8-year-old on their birthday. She was wearing a kind of tiara, and which she would happily share with her younger 5-year-old sister. But we ended up having a really wonderful conversation. And I find that that's often the case with 8-year-olds. I'm sure a lot of you adults in the room think you're really mature and smart and have lots of really good questions to ask, but I really find that I get stuck with 8-year-olds on how to answer some of their questions. And she asked me a very interesting question. She asked me, what's the most important question? Do any of you have a good answer to that? Huh? Any of you have what's the most important question? Huh? No ready answer, right? Not easy. I said, why? I said, why? And she asked me, why? Back. And I said, look, I think it's been my experience. I was trained as a scientist, and I worked a long time with engineers. I mean, I had to make some money and pay back all my college debt, right? So you don't have the luxury when you finish college these days to kind of cruise around. I didn't anyway. I was putting myself through school and college. So I had to make some money, and I got a job as an engineer. I was given a job by somebody for which I was very grateful for. But when I worked a long time with engineers, I discovered that they tend to ask the question, how? Something would break down, how are we going to fix it? Something was a mess, how do we fix it up? And I kept on asking why. Why did it break down? Why are we in this mess again? You know, and I mean, sometimes it's very helpful in life to ask how are we going to fix this? You know, or how are we going to contain the situation? How are we going to protect ourselves? But I found over time, and in work, it was far more critical to step back and ask why, why? Because we would get down to the root cause of things if we worked with this how question. So I was having a really interesting conversation with this young 8-year-old, and she really didn't hold back in the end. Like, she was just really going at me full belt with, lots and lots of questions. I had to get her parents to hold back from them trying to gag the little girl. Because parents really think that that a person should be, especially a girl, should be perfect and pretty and nice and be seen and not heard. And it's just the nature of 8-year-olds. They are natural born scientists, and I get it. I love those kids, They want to know what's going on in the world and why and how, and they want to engage with it and play with it. So I'd like to engage, try to get all of you guys to ask why do we give? Why do we receive? Is there a difference between giving and receiving? And, you know, what are the benefits of this? So I'd like to maybe get you all to explore today what we call gratitude. We can also call it generosity. And I'm not asking you to think about this, meaning like give me a smart answer, give me something from the Dhamma school that you may have attended one time, some set definition. I want us to work together as a group, because I'm no more an expert on this in some ways than you are, but maybe collectively we can crowdsource some sort of understanding of this very, very important topic of gratitude and generosity. And we're going to do some experiments on this, so I'd just like you to sit as comfortably and as relaxed as you can, because I want us to just open our hearts to the experience of giving and receiving, and how do we feel about that? What's the experience? Because it was really interesting to be with this 8-year-old who was able to, you know, really bounce around questions in her mind, and sitting next to her with a little 5-year-old who really struggled to come up with any questions at all, but just really wanted to be loved and acknowledged and accepted and put on the tiara on her head too and joined in this birthday. So while we are very mature adults at this stage of our lives, most of us, and I want us to connect with our little 8-year-old asking some questions, and maybe our little 5-year-old selves. We just want to feel loved and accepted and acknowledged in this world and have their question answered too. So maybe I can just ask you to recall a time where you received something. Somebody gave you something and you really appreciated it. Geez, thanks so much. That's really great. I'm very grateful for this present, for this gift. Or it could have been a gift of their person's time or their knowledge. It could be somebody who just helped you to settle down on your first day at work, or somebody who maybe shoved over on the school bench and let you sit next to them and were your friend, and maybe they become your friend for life. Or maybe it was a neighbor who just looked out for you and had your back when you were, you know, getting up to mischief when you were young. Or maybe it was just receiving a birthday present. Or maybe you were brought to the temple when you were young, from a young age, and you were, you know, you didn't understand it. You knew that it was kind of a lot of, you got a lot of respect and kudos if you gave generously to the monks. You know, a lot of people would praise you. Your parents would be so happy, and your grandparents would be so happy to see you giving something over to the monks. I mean, many of you now are parents and grandparents, and you try to encourage your kids to do the same thing, to get a joy out of generosity, to tap into that experience, that subtle pleasure. So I really want you to get this kinetic experience, as if you're like a dancer almost. You remember it in your body. Maybe you remember it by the smell. Maybe you can remember it by the hearing. Maybe you can remember it by the touch or by the taste. You know, when somebody puts kiribati into your mouth, spoons it in, maybe like at a wedding ceremony, it's like a gift. Or somebody says, here, let me share this with you. Do you want to taste this or smell this? Or somebody gives you a bouquet of flowers. Or you're receiving something that really lifts your heart. I want you to recall that experience in your mind. You know, it could have been just getting a clap on your back at a sporting event, where somebody really appreciated your gift of maybe how well you bowled, or how well you batted, or how well you fielded something. Or it could be just the gift of seeing somebody else doing well in life, and you take it into your heart as a gift. That was such an honor to really see and experience this great gift of humanity. Maybe some of you are old enough to remember the first man putting a step on the moon or something like that that really uplifted you, and you kind of felt really happy to be part of civilization. And I'm looking at it whatever the event is, we can always replay it and look at it again from a perspective of gratitude and generosity. What is a giving and a receiving? And sometimes it's just amazing when we give something to somebody else and they receive it, and you can see that they're really happy to receive it, and they feel like, oh, thanks so much. And then you're like, I'm so grateful to even, you know, have the opportunity to give this to you, you know? You're the person I was looking to give this to share this with. So sometimes it's just nice to acknowledge that in our hearts is a thank you. Thanks so much. How very kind of you. How did you know? That's so kind, that's so thoughtful of you. That's really sweet. Thank you so much. And you can just say this in any language that's meaningful to you, that goes, the words that go to your heart. Say this in a way that's kind and loving to yourself, that will really express how you would feel generosity. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Maybe we can just take that sense now of gratitude and just say thank you to my head. To my head, to the top of my head, the back of my head, the right side of my head, the left side of my head, my forehead, my eyes, my ears, my nose, my mouth. Thank you to my whole head. Thank you for this great gift you bring into my life. And thank you to my neck for the articulation, for the vocal cords, for the thyroid, for all the other things that you bring into my life. Thank you so much. Really putting on this feeling of gratitude into our whole embodiment of it. And thank you to my shoulders for lifting and carrying. And let me put down any burden that might exist in my shoulders, like shopping baskets. If I put down shopping bags, the left arm, the right arm, just releasing that tension from the shoulders, releasing any tension that may exist about worries about the past or anxiety about the future. And thank you to my shoulders for carrying this burden. But now, in gratitude, just let it relax. And thank you to my arms and my hands, which are so often involved in the giving and receiving. Maybe I can remember that event of gratitude that I'm recalling in terms of my arms and hands giving and receiving. I welcome and thank you so much to my own chest and lungs. Normally when I receive something that touches my heart, my air, the breathing changes in my heart. Also changes in its beat and rhythm. It slows down and it syncs with the other person. I feel in tune with them in the giving and the receiving. Thank you so much with all my heart. And again to my intestines and stomach, thank you so much. You can feel the strength and the nourishment of receiving, you know, maybe some food or something like that, and how it fortifies the body. And again, thank you to my back and spine, my upper back, middle back, lower back, and radiating ribs, the delicate spinal column, cord. Thank you so much for keeping me upright and supporting me, for being at my back like a true friend. Thank you so much for your support. And thank you to my hips and pelvis. Thank you for the solidity, the foundation that any generous friend is, how they support our life again by being somebody who's there for us, somebody who's a real brick in our life. And thank you to our thighs for the great power and strength. Thank you so much. I'm grateful for how you help me to lift and stand and walk and move and swim and do all these things. And thank you to my knees, my calf, my shins. Thank you for helping me bend and flex and put in a spring in my step. And thank you to my heel and foot and toes. again, great friends, how we can such as almost take them for granted, how they carry us around in the world. But yet are there, they're kind of intelligent and very capable. Our feet are so very capable. And let's just put this whole body together, the feet, the legs, the torso, the arms, the neck and the head. And let's just express our deep gratitude to our own body and mind. Thank you so much to this body and mind for supporting this life that I live today, for the gift that each and every part of you is bringing into my life. Thank you so much. And just as I feel a gratitude towards myself, let me just radiate that gratitude outward to all the people in this room, to everybody around me, all of my neighbors and friends and fellow Dhamma practitioners, all around me. Thank you to every one of you for the gifts that you bring into my life, your kindness, your generosity, your sharing in this journey of life, for your gifts that are material, but also of sila, morality, and your gifts of bhavana, the culture and the cultivated minds that each and every one of you bring into my life, that we share in this journey, we share in this investigation this morning into gratitude. We're co-investigators. And let's just overspill this sense of gratitude while we're out into the city, this beautiful Melbourne city this morning, this winter morning. And we are grateful to all of our neighbors and friends all around us here in Melbourne. Thank you to every one of you, each and every one of you in all directions. Thanks to all Melbourneians this morning. And let's just spread it out wider. Thanks to this whole lucky nation, this whole lucky land. Across the whole of Australia, thank you so much. And let's just spread it out wider to New Zealand and Indonesia, all around us, our neighbors. And let's just go for a walk and we can move further up through Southeast Asia, through Singapore and Malaysia, Thailand, Indonesia, Cambodia, Laos, Philippines, this whole region. Thanks to all of our friends and neighbors in this whole region. And moving now along, following the sun, shining a light of gratitude on South Asia, India, Sri Lanka, Bangladesh, Nepal, Pakistan, this whole region. Thank you so much for the gifts you bring into my life. This gift of gratitude we're even talking about today is a method we're following it from the Indian tradition. Moving further along after the sun, we can come across to the Middle East, through Afghanistan, Iran, Iraq, Syria, Israel, Palestine, Yemen, Lebanon, this whole region. Thank you so much for the gifts. Gifts of democracy, writing, days of the week, iron fabrication, you name it. There's so many things coming out of this region that are great gifts of civilization, of culture. And thank you so much to Africa, from the Egyptian pyramids across from Morocco down to South Africa. Great continent, great beings, animals, people, leaders like Nelson Mandela. Food, music, dance. And thank you so much to Europe, from Italy and Spain through Scandinavia, from Ireland and the UK, right across to Russia. Thank you so much to Europe for the history, the culture, the science. Whatever it is that appeals, that is a gift in my life. And thank you so much to the Americas, North America, Central America, South America. Gifts like a man walking on the moon, or maybe it could be music, or dance, or sport and soccer, whatever it is that appeals to the mind of the gift. And thank you so much, We're going further east again, over to the Far East, to Japan and China, Vietnam, Korea, Mongolia, Tibet, this whole region. Thank you so much for giving great gifts of culture, of food, music, whatever it is that appeals to you as a gift. So let's just step back from this whole planet a little bit and just maybe we can express our deep gratitude to this globe, this planet Earth, for all the gifts it brings into our life. Everything we've ever given or received has happened on this globe. The gift of air, of water, of life, of earth, of wind, of sun. Thank you so much for this gift, for this home, for this place that I live. And maybe we can just relax, put down all this burden of going around the world. And just relax, we can imagine we're just lying where the sun is, as if it was a sofa or somewhere very comfortable. Moving deeper and deeper into the heart of this gratitude, this gratitude that we're experiencing. Thank you so much. And we just have that sense of gratitude to all beings in all directions. North, south, east, west, above and below. Just any direction, we can overflow, overspilling from our heart in all directions, just like an overflowing fountain. As if it was just spreading out wider, or like a candle in the night, a light going out into the dark, warming and brightening up the whole universe around us in all directions. Thank you to all beings in all directions. And just as I feel gratitude to all beings in all directions, so too do I feel gratitude to myself. Appreciative of this moment in time, and just appreciative of appreciation itself. Grateful for gratefulness. Thank you to all beings in all directions. Having this connection with all beings in all directions, just connected by this feeling in the heart of gratitude. I'm grateful to be alive, I'm grateful for this moment, I'm grateful for this place in this whole universe, I'm grateful to all beings around me. Whatever living being they may be, whether they are weak or strong, the great or the mighty, the medium, short or small. Even as a mother, we protect with our life, her child, her only child, so too is a boundless heart, and I feel grateful to all beings in all directions. Thank you so much. Radiating this gratitude over the entire world, spreading upwards to the skies and downwards to the depths, outwards and unbounded, freed from any stinginess and niggardliness. This great feeling of gratitude. Thank you so much. So as I lie here on my solar, my place in the sun, as it were, feeling grateful, how do I feel in my heart? Can I check in with my body and my mind? How do I feel? What's this experience of gratitude like? Is this warm or cool? Is this bright or dark? Is this a peaceful place or a discontented place? Am I at ease or am I at dis-ease? How do I feel in my heart? What is the tone? What is the ambience? What is the feeling? What is this experience? What am I grateful for right now? And how does that make me feel? Can I distinguish between giving and receiving? Which is better, to give or to receive? How does that feel in my heart right now? Can I see my hand reaching out to accept? Can I see my hand receiving and bringing it back into my body? Or can I also see myself holding precious this gift that I wish to give somebody else and giving it to them and feeling that joy when they accept it and appreciate it, that it's a gift that's well received? Can I see that sign of just giving and receiving, being worthy of receiving something, of having somebody acknowledge my humanity and giving me maybe their time or their thoughtfulness, their care, their consideration, or seeing that I too can be one of those thoughtful, caring, considerate beings, just giving and receiving. Just like the air going in and out of my lungs, just as the universe is giving me the air, and then I engage back, giving back my air, breathing in, breathing out. And I can just breathe into this situation. Maybe I can just use this mantra of thank on the in-breath, you on the out-breath. Not directing it at anybody in particular, not at myself, not just my gift, my exchange with this whole universe. Thank you. Again, I just inquire, how do I feel? What's this experience of gratitude like? Is this something I welcome into my life? Why not? Is this something I wish to grow? Why not? How does this feeling in my heart feel like? Can I find my way back to this place? Can I find my way from remembering that time that I gave or received? Having gratitude for different parts of my own body. Having gratitude for all beings around me, radiating outwards, starting from where I am through this room, across the world, to finally this place in the middle of the universe, the middle of the solar system. Is this a place that I enjoy? Do I find pleasure? Do I find peace, contentment? Is there samadhi here? Is there equanimity of mind? This is reflection on gratitude. A very key concept or idea in Buddhism is that we have done good deeds in the past. So whether you realize it or not, this whole meditation we did today pivots around that you have not just only done good deeds in the past, but you've been a recipient of good deeds in the past. And there's all kinds of good deeds that we can do. We can do good deeds in body, in speech, and in mind. We can do good deeds that are generosity in body, what we generally call dana, meaning like gifts of our material wealth, our prosperity. We can also give gifts of morality. For instance, today we talked about not harming other beings. So it's not just telling us to don't do things, it's also advising us to do things that are beneficial to the well-being of other beings. So it isn't just simply that I don't harm other beings, it's also what am I doing to promote the well-being and the welfare of other beings. We say, don't take things without permission. This is the second precept. But it also means to find skillful ways to give things to people. Panativata. Adinadana. Adinadana means without, not to take without permission. But that's the don't do side of it, what we call the omission. But the commission is that we need to practice generosity, on the other hand. Kamesu means, basically, it's mostly focused on sexual violation or boundaries, but it means basically physical violations and boundaries, so we don't invade other people's physicality without permission or in an unskillful way, but on the other hand, it means we promote that physical welfare and well-being of other people. But they feel psychologically safe, you could say, around us. And then there's the speech part, where we're told not to lie, and also not to be divisive, not to be foul-mouthed, not to trash talk people. But on the other hand, it means, you know, speak meaningfully, try to unite people, find kind ways to speak in the world, and be honest and be truthful. And then finally, not to be deluded. This final thing about not taking things that delude or intoxicate the mind. Basically, it meant in the old days alcohol, but these days it's a little bit more wide in meaning. But in other words, it means also on the other side of it, it means to do things that promote the clarity of mind. So like today we're doing that. We're doing this, we're promoting our clarity of mind. So this is like in broad brushstrokes of morality that we live by, what we call the five precepts. It makes sense. And then we can also cultivate our mind, just like this morning we've been cultivating a sense of gratitude. And in that we use memory. We need to recall and experience. So the word in Pali for memory is sati. I mean, sometimes you hear satipatthana and sati meditation, meaning mindfulness, but actually the word sati also means to remember, to recollect, to recall. Both are very, can't be separated out. If you have good awareness, you'll have good memory. Like sometimes people say that they were forgetful, but often the root of their forgetfulness is that they weren't paying attention in the first place. So we'd say garbage in, garbage out. But this whole thing of cultivating the mind and heart, it starts with what we call sutta-maya-panya, listening to the Dhamma, listening to spoken word, and historically it was more spoken. It's only very recent history that we have a written culture. It's only extremely recently that we have literacy in the world. So for most of humanity, it was a spoken word. So we had to hear the teachings, and this great faculty that the human has over many other beings, of where we can learn from each other and exchange large amounts of information with each other, and training and pass on, so that we do genuinely stand on the shoulders of giants. We all know of Newton in this room, Isaac Newton, who, you know, wrote a lot of the work, the laws of physics, down for us. So we don't have to go out and relearn, invent the wheel again. We can just hear about how to invent a wheel, you know, how to make a wheel. So this is learning. And then we need to reflect on it. They call chittamayapanya, reflecting on it. We think about it. We use inference. We use deduction. We reflect on it. We compare it to our own experience, maybe. We take the theory and we maybe compare it. Think about it carefully. Does it make sense or not? And finally, we need to have what we call bhavamayapanya. Bhava means cultivate. You cultivate cattle, you cultivate rice, you can cultivate the mind and the heart. But it's also really referring to to a direct experience. You know, you have direct experience, just as a farmer knows how to farm, or a gardener knows how to garden. Maybe two others, we just see the paddocks, the fields, the gardens as we pass by, and we look over the fence. We don't know how to really do it in detail. We've never done it. We don't have that feel. We don't have the green fingers. Maybe. So it's referring to this very experiential work that we need to do today. So this morning we've been cultivating, as a group, we've been cultivating a sense of gratitude. So this is the experience of gratitude today. And maybe, you know, maybe you find this calming and peaceful. Maybe it's there's a sense of contentment. You know, it would be interesting to hear from you how what was your experience of today? Because we all have a common, we have a shared experience. You have your information, I have mine, and we can compare notes, and it becomes a co-investigation, and we can share. We can become, as they, you know, crowdsourcing. We use these words today, crowdsourcing and shared economy and all that, but we can have a shared intelligence, a shared experience, and the sum is greater than the individual parts. You know, am I absolutely right? No. But together we can be probably on the ball. We can probably, as a group now, have a fairly good idea about what gratitude is. What is the taste? What is the experience of giving and receiving? What is the taste, what is the experience of gratitude? Because we can't see it. There is no, you know, there is no edifice, there is no solid thing out there called gratitude. This is an experience, a thing that is happening within our heart. Right within our heart. It's an aspect of mind. So, you know, this exists in our mind. So if we're going to know about it, we need to share our experience, a little bit about that. And collectively, we have a very good idea about this space in our heart, this space of gratitude. So gratitude, the experience of gratitude, this phenomenon that's in our heart, is the opposite in nature to stinginess. Stinginess, scarcity. Impoverishment of the mind, scarcity of the mind. So in all things we have necessities, we have needs. We need food, we need clothing, we need shelter, we need medicine. These are necessities. It's not something that we can trade on. You know, if you're sick, you know, you can't skip over requirement around medicine. If you're hungry, you can't really skip over meal. You know, these are necessities. So if you are beyond your necessities, if you have more than necessary, then we're in wealth. If I was to ask any of you in this room, most of you in this room, are you wealthy? I think you'd all try to duck that one, that question. I ask it frequently of people. Are you wealthy? I say, oh, I'm not that wealthy. I could earn some more money. Well, do you have your necessities? Oh yes, do you think I'm poor? Are you saying I'm poor? You know, when we have more than enough, we can give. If we don't have enough, we can't give. So this is the kind of icebreaker, really. If you can give, you will have wealth. If you try to give and you don't have wealth, you'll find that it's quite toxic. There's a kickback in that. You'll find that I'm giving just to please others, or I'm giving even though it's kind of bankrupting me. You know, you feel really squeezed and unhappy and unpleasant about this kind of action of being forced into give something. But when we can give generously and open-heartedly and know in our heart, wholeheartedly, that this is something I'm enjoying, and this is well within my means, then we're giving from a generosity, a generous place. And that is wealth. That is a very, very experience of wealth. Mm-hmm. And it's all kinds of wealth. We can get so narrow these days that wealth equals cash. Wealth does not equal cash. yes, it's useful to have money, but there are other kinds of wealth. There are people who are very knowledgeable. There are people who are very talented in sport. There are people who are great musicians, great in all kinds of talents and skills. And there is this spiritual wealth too. It's a very strange kind of wealth. But it's perhaps the highest wealth. And I think it's characterized by peace. Its taste is peace. Just as the taste of all the oceans is salt, you'll find that strong spiritual wealth is the taste of peace, especially in the face of adversity. It's easy to be peaceful when the wind is at your back. But when you run into the crosswinds or the headwinds of life, are you at peace with that? Are you open and accepting of the nature? Are you able to bow down and learn from your teachers from hell? How does the difficulties of life present themselves? You can find all the tea in China and all the money in the world doesn't necessarily buy happiness, peace, and contentment. Wealth in the ordinary sense of the word is freedom of choice. I can have what I want. But the taste of spiritual wealth is I am free from choice. I'm at peace with the way things are. This is okay. This is good enough. This is good enough for this day and night. And I'm deeply grateful. I'm very deeply grateful. So when we're in the good company of wholesome states of mind, we find that they tend to hang out together. We can move from one wholesome state of mind to another. If I feel gratitude, I'm also probably likely to be able to feel friendly. I'm also able to probably see, have compassion for somebody who's in a tough spot. I can feel all these positive states of mind. I can feel peace, I can feel joy, I can feel contentment, I can feel what we call samadhi, calm and peacefulness, I can feel equanimity. They come together. They're in a group. Just like here today, we're all in a group, here we're together. You know, similarly, there's another group somewhere else maybe in some other part of the world that are all together and they're brawling and fighting and, you know, they're the unwholesome states of mind, shall we say. The anger, the hate, the greed, the disappointment, the bitterness, the stinginess, the scarcity of mind, all of that, they all hang out together. If you have one, you'll have the other. They use the word comorbid. Comorbid. They all hang out together. If you have one of these illnesses, you're highly likely to have another of them. They just flip from one to the other. So I'd like to use the other word that we would have around these maybe positive wholesome states of mind. It's symbiotic. They all come together and they're very interlinked and interwoven. They build on each other. The sum is greater than the individual parts. And it's quite remarkable. So as we go forward in our life, I'd like to suggest that today we've been talking about the way and the means towards like really growing a strong sense of gratitude. And, you know, it's for your own self to find, to make your own discoveries around how gratitude, you know, rocks, how it kind of beautifies my life, how it not just enhances, how wonderful it is. I don't know how you want to say it. It's just an amazing superpower in its own way, the sense of gratitude. I really find it very, very helpful in difficulty. I was always frustrated in especially in Buddhist circles, there can be a lot of shaming around, you know, somebody says that they're angry or they're upset, and somebody would just say, oh, just let go, which sounds really mystic, isn't it? Just let go. And I was always just perplexed, because I had my issues around letting go of difficulty and anger and things like that. And other people would just, you know, just shame you by saying, well, just let go of it. And I was really perplexed. So I spent many years working on this. And one of the ways and means that I use is gratitude. You know, what am I grateful for? There's all kinds of tools. And I found that it's good to have many tools because not all of them work on the same day. But I found gratitude to be very, very helpful as a way and means to let go, at least to move into a recovery position. You know, it's like the, I don't know if this is politically correct or not, but there's a joke, it's an old joke, you have to remember this is a kind of kid's joke, but you know, what's the first thing a leper does in the morning? You know, body count. So the joke is like, well, what am I grateful for? I need to do my own body count here. You know, when I'm in difficulty, check in with my body, how do I feel, and what am I grateful for? What am I grateful for? You know, so this is really helpful, and there's been quite a lot of studies around people who have been through, you know, very difficult situations. And a key commonality in recovery, people who successfully recover from very difficult situations, is that they're almost immediately, almost as soon as a traumatic event arises, the thought co-arises for these people that, what are they grateful for? They're in a car crash. I'm grateful that the airbags deployed. The car's a light off. I'm grateful that I'm alive. They broke their arm. I'm grateful that I can, you know, I can recover from this. What am I grateful for? It's an incredible talent and skill. And you can't expect it to be there if you haven't already cultivated it and grown it. It does exist in every one of us. You know, there is a sense of gratitude in our hearts, but it's up to us to grow it and take care of it and nurture it. Just as a good gardener would grow from the seeds, the seedlings that become the great a mighty oak or redwood in the forest. It's up to you how much nutriment that you give to gratitude in your heart. You own that. That's your responsibility. You know? And it doesn't matter how impoverished a situation you came from, we all have an opportunity to grow and cultivate gratitude in our heart. And it can be quite remarkable, the experience. I was remembering, I was reading an account of some of the Auschwitz survivors. It's a book, I'm sorry, I've just forgotten the name of the author and the title of the book. It'll come to me as I mention it. But the author was being shown a picture of Auschwitz, and the people were saying how absolutely terrible these people are. It's just the bottom of the barrel. And he said, how do you know? How do you know how that person is feeling, even in that horrific situation? Because he himself could remember some of the highest experiences of his life. He said, just looking at a cloud over the fence. Or, you know, they would sleep together in these lagers on a communal bed. And he said he never slept so soundly that whole time when he would be sharing 12 men to a blanket. And this thing, he had very positive experiences in that time. You know, so it can really diminish the experience of another to say, well, that obviously was really the worst. How do you really know? What am I grateful to? Even in the worst of situations, it can be really remarkably helpful. And I mentioned this the last time I was teaching, but recently my father passed away, and in the moment of his passing away, I felt really, really good. And I was really perplexed about that. It felt like gratitude. It felt like I was so grateful to my father. And it really felt like he was teaching me in his dying breath, literally in his dying breath, was not to be afraid of death. Because he passed away with a lot of, he powered down on his breath. He just powered down. And I was really grateful to that. Because he didn't really prepare himself for death, even though I was with him the day before and he didn't really. He wasn't concerned about death, he wasn't thinking about it, he wasn't afraid of death, he was just not on the agenda. He thought he was going to get out of this ICU situation. Because he'd done it before, he was a bullet dodger. This wasn't going to be, this is going to be another trick, he'd get out of here too. But he didn't. But at the same time, in the end, he passed in a very peaceful way. I'm very grateful for that. I can really remember it. It's very strange if you develop this skill of gratitude. It's a bit like your airbags. They're sort of hidden behind your wheel or behind your dashboard, and you just don't even know that they're there. Then bang, you're in a crash, and they deploy, and you go, oh my gosh, thanks to these airbags, my gosh, that's amazing. You know, so I recommend that you cultivate this skill, and it is a skill. And you'll find that it is a wonderful antidote to scarcity, that impoverishment of mind where nothing is good enough, and no matter what I have, it's not enough. And let me tell you, it's got nothing to do with how much money you have. I mean, sure, if you've got less than you need, you're pinched, and it's tough, I get that, I'm not dismissing that. But if you have more than you need, you are in wealth. You are in wealth as long as you can see that and acknowledge it for yourself. It doesn't require you to particularly go out and start giving away your last penny. But just acknowledge it in your heart. I feel grateful. What have I got to be grateful for today? Can I be grateful for something? And one of the teachers that I came across, he said, he was asked what was his motivation, why did he become this meditation teacher, and he said he wanted to appreciate the little purple flowers on the side of the road. That was why he was interested in meditation. And I certainly see the more I practice this life, that I have more and more appreciation and gratitude for the little things. Like spending a real birthday with an 8-year-old. So thank you very much for sharing this reflection with me, and I'd be very happy to hear about our respective co-investigation this morning into gratitude. So maybe we can, if there's any, do we have time for questions? Or something like that?
That should be two questions.
If there's any questions, can I ask, was anybody traumatized by that this morning? Is that difficult or traumatic? Is it something you'd like to do again? Well, what's stopping you? Huh? Do I have to call down to your office at a time that would suit you and it would be really convenient? Huh? Do I have to sit next to you in the passenger seat when you're stuck at the traffic jam? You do a little gratitude together while you're stuck in traffic. Could you do this by yourselves? What's stopping you? If you want to know about this growth, and we can come and talk about all the wonderful things of how gratitude has informed your life, colored your life.
So the book, was it A Man's Search for Meaning?
Yeah, that's what it was. A Man's Search for Meaning. What's his name?
Viktor Frankl.
Yeah. Beautiful book. Beautiful book, Viktor Frankl. What a gift. Man's Search for Meaning. Incredible.
But then, what if we try to search for that sense of gratitude in the heart and that sense doesn't come up?
Yeah, it happens. I mean, I was teaching this in a prison, and one of the prisoners, instead of like feeling maybe nice and calm, like a lot of you, got very angry. And he really couldn't remember a situation in his life where he'd received anything. And, you know, I don't know if it's possible for people to receive nothing in life. I mean, I think some of the Romanian babies, a few years ago, there was these Romanian babies, and they were just kind of housed in cribs by themselves from day one. But I think that there is always something to be grateful for in most of our lives. And, you know, it is that scarcity of mind that is arising at that time that would block us from seeing that we have been recipients of things in our life, and also that we have been givers in our life. And what we need to do is to not argue and not wrestle with that scarcity of mind, not say shame it by saying we're wrong, because that's just really going to make it even worse, that we're, you know, I'm not grateful for anything, and how bad is that? You know, that scarcity squared, you know, that's a trick of the mind, that perfectionism, that all that kind of quite toxic mind states, just building one on top of the other. And so the thing, like, there's a lot of things that can be done. Like, we can just question that reality. Is that really true? Is it really true that I have never received anything? Is that absolutely true? Is that absolutely, totally, 100%? You know, I lived in Malaysia, and there was a secretary of the meditation center where I lived and worked. She really grew up in a lot of poverty. It was a Gore family. And her mother had to work, so she couldn't be breastfed. And they had no food other than rice water. That's what she had as a child, just rice water. And I didn't grow up in rice water. I grew up in porridge. But I discovered rice water when I was really sick in 2008 in Burma. I had colitis and I was just really sick. And I spent about 3 weeks at a monastery, and they would give me rice water for breakfast and for lunch. And I was putting down a couple of liters of rice water for breakfast and lunch. And the big joke with the abbot was like, oh, you know, look at the white fellow, look at how much rice water he's putting down. Like, I would have rice water for lunch, who was the appetizer, main course, and dessert. This was quite a rich monastery, and they were really looking after me. I went from liquid to solid rice water. You know what I mean? Like, they started to introduce little bits of rice in it, and bits of meat, a fish. And I remember I met this secretary later on, and we were talking about rice water, and she was saying to me, rice water is still the taste of mother's milk to me, you know? And I was saying, yeah, God, I totally get that. You know, and I really feel great gratitude to rice water, not even to the person necessarily giving it to me, to the properties of rice water itself. And I was really grateful to the Buddha. You see, the Buddha gave a sutta on the five qualities of rice water. It's called the Yagu Sutta. And it was like every one of them were true. And I was like, yeah, it's totally true. You know, it was like, I don't know if you get it, like, it's like this, like, yeah, totally, the Buddha was totally honest with the Yagyu Sutta, you know. I was like, God, yeah, the Buddha was so wise, you know, like, you know, if you've been really sick, and you're just like, oh, I'm so grateful to rice water. But it is something to cultivate, you know, because especially when we're in a dark place at times, it's not like gratitude is maybe instantly there, but like, that's why people will tell me, oh, I don't have time to meditate, Dante. And I'm like, oh, right, so you're going to meditate when you feel you have time, or when you feel badly, or when you're dying, or what is it, when are you going to do it? I'm like, can't you make hay while the sun is shining? You know, like, do you have to be really in a dark place to develop gratitude? I mean, the best time and the best place is now, you know, when you're in a good place, when you're in a good situation. And, sorry, you've got a car.
We've got a car that's blocking. It's RWZ. Just trying to, RWZ 892, and in the same driveway there is another car blocking as well, and the lady is very, very upset. So could the person for owning that car please remove it?
Thank you. Is it the car park, is it?
No, it's in the street. And the lady has had problems before, so I think we will need to do some work with her. Okay, thank you.
Yes, it's in the street.
RWZ 892. So this is, we have to realize that a lot of all the emotions are contagious. So somebody else's stinginess and niggardliness can bring us down. So we have to be careful around that and, be generous with ourselves above all, especially when we're in proximity to people who are in scarcity. They're not in poverty, they're in scarcity. Scarcity is, for me, the psychological component of stinginess, niggardliness. And it's not pleasant. It's not, if you saw a YouTube clip of somebody just being really, really stingy, really niggardly, really, it just doesn't look good. It's not like you put it on a billboard, Whereas as generosity, gratitude, there's lots of like little YouTube clips going around the planet of somebody doing like spontaneous acts of generosity. And there was a survey, a worldwide survey of generosity in countries, and you have to kind of take carefully these surveys and questions. But the question asked was, have you recently given to a stranger? So when they asked this question on generosity, do you know where the top three countries were? You know, the number one country on generosity, as in answering the question, have you recently given something to a complete stranger? Top country in the world?
Burma?
I think you'd heard this question before. It's Burma. By a long distance, something like 75 in every country have given recently. So it's a very strong culture in Burma. And I have to say, having experienced the cyclone Nargis and the tsunami in Burma, the generosity of the people there is just staggering. It's just staggering. That is literally a place where you have to tell people to not give more than they can afford. They will. It's a mystery at times how they used to give to support the Sangha, to support. I as a Westerner, I was wealthy, officially wealthy compared to them, and It was really touching. I really had to go into my heart and overcome my own scarcity at receiving from people who were, probably in many ways didn't have the access to the wealth that I had in some ways, or hadn't had. It was just so touching to me. It was a really big practice for me to really look at my life and say, what can I be generous with? And find things that were there. The scarcity of mind can be very pervasive, especially in a material culture, where everything is all about what have you got rather than what have you given. Again, Andrew Carnegie, famous quote from him was, you know for what you give, not what you received. And he had 75 billion in modern terms. Again, we're going to, maybe in history, I don't know, it stands the test of time, but we may know Gates and Warren Buffett for what they gave, not what they took. I hope so. That would be a nice legacy of theirs, where they, skillfully spend down their earnings over their lifetime. Buffett has a stipulation that his wealth is to be dissipated within 10 years of his death. He's already giving away, I think, about $3 billion per annum, and he's still in the number three spot in the world or something. Wealth and generosity are not indirectly. You don't have to be poor to be wealthy, if you know what I mean, spiritually. You can be very wealthy and generous, and you can be very wealthy, you know, financially cashed up and very stingy. That's a choice. That's in your heart. So these are the skills. So if you don't feel gratitude off the bat, you know, maybe that's a place to explore, to investigate into. And it's often easier if I don't feel any generosity to think of, like that's why I asked you to really think carefully about a time that you've experienced in the past where you gave or you received. And, you know, using trigger words like thank you, but it could be in another language, like xie xie ni, prima kase, whatever, gave me the falcha. Whatever language it is for you that triggers that kind of word, and it is like a dance. You know, it's like you can put on the gratitude tune and dance to it, where you just get it, or, you know, you come down to the dhammas that are happening here. You know, this isn't some sort of religious rite and act and some sort of, this is people doing generous things, and you can see people getting happy. You know, so you can get off on the happiness of others. We call that mudita. You can leverage their happiness. You can leverage their generosity. You can feel good about what other people are doing. And it does promote your own sense of generosity. You know, whether you like it or not, you're going to be primed. Your mind is going to get primed or anchored into doing that thing yourself. And it may not be immediate, but across the day and across the week, that will inspire your mind automatically. It's a conditioning, it's a conditioning factor. So there's a lot of good research on that. So just as like the advertisement will prime you to maybe gratify your sort of scarcity by going in and doing some shopping therapy, you know, just coming and seeing people offering food down and that can really help you to be a more generous person. And the real value in generosity is that you are combating the inner disease of scarcity, of stinginess, of niggardliness. And these are really impoverishing. So, you know, I get to see people of all slices across life, and I've been with people who have incredible scarcity, even though they're incredibly wealthy. And I've met people who were very, very poor, materially very poor, but were in great wealth. You know, real wealth, what I would call wealth, is having more than enough. And we're capable of that in society and in this whole planet. You know?